So I'm Dr. Marco Vespignani. Everyone just really calls me Dr. Marco or Marco. I practice in Seattle. I'm a naturopathic doctor. I'm licensed here in California as well as Washington. For about 6 years, I worked in a neurology clinic in Davis in California. And that's where I, you know, really learned about neurology, and that's what became my focus. And now my practice, I work a lot with neurological conditions. And so as a more holistic physician, I'm always trying to think about, you know, what are ways that you can help people that, you know, not necessarily just saying, you know, no medications, because I don't believe that, but what's the rest of the things that we can do to try to help people? And so I'm going to just skate right through this because you guys have had a ton of this already. But suffice to say that in an autoimmune process, the major issue is that what you have is the immune system that's generally focused on the outside world and attacking singular targets that kind of come into your life. When that process gets aimed inward, it's a much more complicated process because you're not going to lose some aspect of that. If your immune system starts to recognize your own DNA, what are you going to do about that, right? I mean, that's something that's hard to get that dog to let go of that bone. So when it comes to diet, different than something like Rituxan, which is going to suppress that response, you know, not entirely, but quite a bit, diet's more of a subtle shifting of the inflammatory background. What states lead to more inflammation and what kind of states lead to a little less inflammation, and how can you on a daily basis control that just a little bit, right? The damage that occurs in autoimmune occurs through inflammatory and oxidative pathways, so I'm going to run through that just for a second. So inflammation is a normal response. We need inflammation. That's how we know something's broken and we need to fix it. So when there's an inflammatory response, the immune system comes by to be like, what happened? How do we fix it? But in an autoimmune process, that normal process becomes abnormal, and you start targeting permanent proteins, and then that response is more sustained, it's longer, and then healing is compromised because you have a sustained inflammatory response. Healing is an important word to me. I really try to convey this thought that life is special, right? I mean, we kind of know that, but the thing that's unique about it is that everything else in the universe is breaking down. Everything else in our life, you know, if I took this computer and slammed it down, I mean, our presentation would be over, but there's no part of my computer that's going to fix itself and suddenly start working again. It's inanimate, right? Life, and specifically humans, can repair. And so as long as you are breathing, as long as there is breath in your body, you are healing. Every breath you take tells your body to reorganize itself and try and fix something. So the process is, how much is something breaking down and how much is it healing, and what's the sum balance? What's the metabolism of that? And so some of my goal with my patients is to try to convey that we need to be working on healing and building and trying slowing down destruction. Inflammation is controlled through specific chemicals, both inside the body and the outside world. If I say anti-inflammatory, right, you should go take an anti-inflammatory, most of us have a picture of our minds of what that would be, you know, some ibuprofen or naproxen or something, right? But most drugs, you know, before the advent of supercomputers, most drugs came from some natural thing that plants, fungus, whatever, it was isolated, discovered, you know, formed into a pill or something. And so a lot of the drugs that we have become familiar with actually start out as natural things. And so my example of that is mint, right? So mint, I put some in my tea. But if you extract the wintergreen oil from that mint and you get a whole mill, you know, a whole dropper of that, that activity in that wintergreen oil is equivalent to about 2 grams of aspirin, which is about 23 baby aspirin. You know, that's, you don't want to take all that. You have a little bleeding problem there. But it gives you an idea that natural things can be converted into things that we have a more relationship in terms of like drugs, right? And that you can take things into your body that have small amounts of anti-inflammatory activity that can support what you're already doing in terms of an anti-inflammatory lifestyle or medication regime or whatever, right? These NSAIDs, you know, your COX-LOX inhibitors, so your ibuprofen, naproxen, Celebrex, But turmeric, which is a natural spice, the Indian food, has a lot of this activity in it. And actually, it's unique because turmeric is one of the few things that has both of these COX and LOX activity, where some things are just one or the other. Even like hops that's in beer, right? Hops has some of this N kappa beta activity, which is actually one level above that in terms of anti-inflammatory. Steroids, some of you have a personal relationship with steroids, and so you know kind of their effect when you have a relapse or when something happens. You have that same thing in your body. You make steroids on your own, and they have this anti-inflammatory response. Now, nothing in your body is really the same as solumedrol, right? But that's just the dose. The process is similar. And so cortisol is something that can be generated. And so there's things you can do dietarily, you know, caloric restriction, which is essentially like skipping a day of food a week. You would get this cortisol response that would raise this anti-inflammatory hormone response because you're hungry. And then that will bring down your inflammation a little bit. There's some pretty clear rat studies in looking at MS, or something called EAE, which is MS in rats, that basically the skinny rats that haven't been fed as much do better than the rats that are overfed. That inflammation and those, you know, the states in those animals that are overfed are usually not as good as the ones that have gone, you know, a third of the calories that the others have. So, and some of that they think it's multifactorial, that, as you know, I'll put in here with the fat, the more adipose tissue that you have in your body, the more interleukin-6 can be generated by that tissue. And interleukin-6 is an inflammatory cytokine. That's something that brings the immune system out. It raises that background. And plus, if you have an underfed, you know, person or animal, they're going to be sending out more cortisol. So you get this two parts of this inflammation where there's less fat and there's more of this steroid response. Excuse me. Sorry, that's annoying. There are foods that can worsen the inflammatory process, and sugar being one of them, right? Sugar itself doesn't really do anything. It's kind of just sugar. It sticks, and that's an issue. You can have things like, you know, with diabetes or states where you have too much sugar that sticks to certain proteins and changes how they function. But just a quick burst of sugar, the problem is more what your body does in response, right? That if you eat a whole Milky Way candy bar, right, that your body now has to try to deal with that sugar. It doesn't want to have all that sugar in your body, in circulating in your bloodstream anyway. And so your pancreas will secrete insulin to try to pull that down. Well, insulin is one of these, you know, hormones that has some inflammatory response. So just by sending insulin out, you raise your inflammation, right? Then what insulin's trying to do is pull all that sugar out of the bloodstream and stick it somewhere so that we can save it for later, because you don't know when that next Milky Way might come. And so you store it, and when you store it, you raise how much fat tissue is there, and so then you start developing more interleukin-6. So now just one burst of sugar has resulted in two states of inflammation. High saturated fat diet, really more to do with the oxidative stress that puts on. Saturated fats are a little bit more oxidative, and so if you have a high saturated fat diet, one, that could, you know, depending on what else comes in with that fat, right? If you only ate fat, then you'd be having like a ketogenic thing, and that might actually work in some places. But if you ate high saturated fats, like a ton of bacon and, you know, a ton of hash browns and chocolate milk and everything else, then this saturated fat level will actually worsen inflammation. And so the Swank diet, which is more of an MS style diet, is a low saturated fat diet, with the idea that these low saturated fats, these high polyunsaturated fats, you will reduce that inflammatory level. You can also have foods that improve your inflammation. So fiber does a few things. One, it can act like insulation and slow how quickly that sugar will be absorbed, slow how quickly that fat will be absorbed. It will pull those, you know, things that you can't digest along with old cells and, you know, toxins or whatever, and just kind of get that out, right? So fiber helps keep the digestive system moving through. Plus fiber, even though we can't digest it, there are organisms that we carry with us that can. And so by eating a high fiber diet, you help to kind of feed the microbiome garden that you have growing in your gut. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. Oxidation, so you may not realize it, but part of, you know, breathing and taking air in is also part of rusting, that we kind of rust on the inside through this oxidative process. And that oxidation is a lot of what the destruction the body is a result of. So antioxidants, again, when I say anti-inflammatories, you get a picture in your mind. When I say antioxidants, you get a picture in your mind of like, oh yeah, the lemonade that was purple downstairs, right? The acai. That there are components in foods that can, or even vitamins or whatever, that can control this oxidative response. And so if you raise your antioxidant intake, you can kind of reverse the rusting that's occurring on the inside that's part of aging and everything else. So the main thing with antioxidants, and really the main thing with diet, I think, is you want to eat all the colors. That when you look at your plate, and this is something you can do every time you eat, when you look at your plate, how many colors do you see? And if you see a lot of white and brown, it's really not helping you that much, right? Sure, there's calories. Sure, there's protein. Yes, it's keeping you alive. It's food. We should be thankful that we have food, right? But without these colors, you're not getting those extra bits of activity that actually make the body work better. And so, you know, I always make the joke about Skittles, right? You want to eat the rainbow, right? They'll sue me one day, I imagine. But the reality is Skittles aren't green because they have chlorophyll or something good in them. They're green because they've got a green dye. You know, they're not red because they have lycopenes in them. They're red because they've got a red dye. And that dye has no biological activity. And if it does, it's probably a small negative, right? There's probably it's a very low chance that the yellow in a Skittle is somehow going to help you, right? It could, but I doubt it, right? It might cause seizures and migraines more than it's going to help you, right? But a bioflavonoid will help to stabilize your mast cells, which are the cells that released IgEs. You know, they'll help to affect your body in some positive way. So you really want to try to get as many colors as you can. The other thing is that you have this master antioxidant, the mother of all antioxidants, right? If you put glutathione into a search engine, one of those top hits is going to say, glutathione, mother of all antioxidants. And essentially because it is a protein, it's a small protein, it's only 3 amino acids, but it's able to grab oxidants from its environment and bring it back to one, you know, central location in the liver and then regenerate that and go back and get more, right? So it's the ultimate rust remover in your body. And you make it. You're making it all the time. But some people make less, and the more, certainly in like secondary progressive MS or looking at, you know, advanced Parkinson's, you see way less glutathione in those brains. When you do MRI scans looking for glutathione levels, there's way less glutathione in an advanced state there. Is that the result, or, you know, we don't know. The correlation there, is that a cause? But glutathione is something that can help to essentially slow the oxidative damage and repair the body, kind of slow aging. The two rate-limiting things, the things that you have to have to make this happen, are N-acetylcysteine, which is an amino acid. This cysteine is a sulfur. And then selenium, which is a trace metal, found in like Brazil nuts and some other things. And so those two things together are essentially the necessary parts to make glutathione. Brassicas, which are your kale, cauliflower, broccoli, cabbage, Brussels sprouts, that whole family of foods, has a component called sulforaphane that actually stimulates the liver to make more glutathione. So when maybe you guys remember the first George Bush, and he didn't like broccoli, and everyone trying to convince him that broccoli was good because it beats cancer or whatever it was, but that essentially broccoli is good because it stimulates your antioxidant mechanisms. It helps to make this work better. Melatonin, which is a hormone that's made in the brain, melatonin's fascinating because, one, it changes how the brain waves function, right? It helps you get into deeper sleep, which helps your brain heal. Plus, it's an antioxidant, so it is a rust remover by itself, and it stimulates the endogenous production of glutathione in the brain. So getting good sleep, I mean, either you make your own melatonin or you put some melatonin in, but melatonin is something that has a trifecta effect on improving how the brain works and repairs. This is what you don't want to eat. Right? This is This is my one meme in here. Reagan. You go out to Fairfield, you can see that whole thing. So the immune response is really based around these immunoglobulins. And these three that I bolded are the ones we seem to know the most about, or at least I know the most about. IgE is what you think of when you think of an allergy. If you have an IgE response to peanuts or bee stings or something, that is when your body swells up, that you are truly allergic to dogs or cats or something, right? And that's a pretty clear response, and it's easy, not easy to test for, but it's generally easy to test for. And it's something that doesn't necessarily increase inflammation beyond a specific point. It's kind of like a landmine or a grenade. You bump into it and it just kind of explodes, right? Then there's IgAs. These are immune globulins that sit in mucous membranes. So they're at the inside of the nose, they're along the gut, and their job is to respond to surface proteins, that when something that you breathe in that might be a problem or something that you eat that might be a problem, it can create an immune response. And then IgGs, which are more of your circulating immune system, this is what you're testing when you're testing for the, you know, NMO antibody, right? You're looking for IgGs to that aquaporin. This is what's produced by those B cells. This is part of that overall inflammatory response. The average person makes hundreds, if not thousands, if not tens of thousands of these of different kinds, right? This is what you react to in the environment, from a tetanus shot to a flu shot to whatever. You're making memory cells against this thing, right? Turns out you can make these against food, right? And so if you're eating a food that sends an IgG response, maybe it's nothing. Maybe it has no clinical implication. Or maybe it somehow raises your inflammatory status a little bit higher so that your whole immune system is a little bit more mad, so that you have all this complement that's being released. And you guys learned about complement a couple hours ago. IgGs to a food protein just as well can bring complement and cytokines over as anything else. And so if you're eating a food that causes some kind of immune response, it might be good to know. So in terms of testing, you can test for these things, right? IgE, you go to an allergist, you get the little square of all the stuff, and they poke you around, and you're like, oh, look, I'm allergic to dust mites, right? You can also do a blood test. IgA, celiac is probably the thing that's most known about IgA. Like, that's the celiac disease. It's basically you can't have gluten or wheat, and if you do, that when you put that food in your body, it actually changes how the small intestine functions, and then you stop absorbing B12, iron, you know, your ability to deal with illness goes down. People with celiac can be sick for a really long time, and I've had patients who were diagnosed with MS that we later found out was celiac, and the lesions that we saw in the brain were not MS lesions, they were celiac lesions. So this could be a serious thing that could go undiagnosed for a long time. And then IgG, you can get a blood test to see what kind of IgGs you respond to. Now, I mentioned you make so many that there's a chance of false positives, right? You might run a blood test for some foods, and there's one thing that's way off the list, and you're like, I've never eaten that in my life. I have no idea what that could be, right? It could be a reaction to some other protein that is similar in size and shape, and just you got a false positive on that test. So whenever I run those food allergy tests, I'm always looking for confirmatories, right? If you have 15 types of dairy that were tested and only milk is off the chart, that's kind of weird, right? Why would just milk be there? But if 14 out of those 15 are elevated, then it's probably there, right? That's probably a chance that dairy is an issue. In terms of supplements that can help the immune system, I'm real targeted in what I like to have people do. I'm not really take a multi, take this, take that. I want to think about what am I trying to change? What's the process, right? And so vitamin D is interesting because it's not really a vitamin, it's a hormone. And it's a very special hormone because it actually helps the immune system to figure out who it is. I think of it as like graduate school for the cells. It helps, you know, the cells differentiating, and it's like, that's a skin cell, and that's a skin cell, and I must be a skin cell. Like, it helps the cells to figure out who they are. In terms of immune cells, it can shift the response from a TH1, which tends to be more of a reactive, even auto-reactive response, to a TH2, which tends to be more of a sustained, less reactive response. So someone who has a high vitamin D level may have less tendency to have inflammatory states. And there's some research looking at higher vitamin D levels just reduce your risk of getting sick as much. And part of the risk, certainly in MS, one of the things we see is that if you get upper respiratory infection or UTI or something else, that raises the chances of a relapse. And you know, I don't really know if that data has been laid out for NMO in the same way, but I wouldn't be surprised if there's some relationship between being sick and seeing relapses. So the cool thing now, if you want to know what all the cool kids are talking about, it's the microbiome, right? That the genome, we've kind of figured it out. Now you get a 23andMe, you can just spit in a bottle and send it out and figure out what country you came from, you know. But now we really want to know what kind of bugs you have in your gut, like how many different kind of bacteria. And so because your genes are really just the potential for something to occur, what you need is the right environment for those genes to kind of start working and replicating. And it turns out that the kind of bacteria you have in your gut makes a difference. And it even makes a difference, were you born vaginally or C-section? Because if you were C-section, you didn't get those bacteria on your first trip out, and so you don't have the same, you know, bacterial makeup that your mother does, right? Were you breastfed? Because that makes a difference, right? So C-section, formula fed, you're gonna have a very different gut than vaginal birth, breastfed. And that initial setup could change the immune system for an adult. And how many rounds of antibiotics did you have as a child? Or how many infections did you have as a child? There's some research looking at if, and these are in other countries, kids who have parasites, you know, under age 4, their risk of autoimmune is essentially none. That if you've been exposed to a parasite, the autoimmune just isn't there. And part of it could be that if your immune system's like, whoa, there's really scary stuff out there, that for the most part, it spends most of its energy looking out and not really turned in. And if you grow up in a home where the dishwasher and lots of, you know, sani wipes and everything else, maybe you haven't had enough exposure, so the immune system gets bored and starts turning inward. I don't know. But that's just some relationship between what's going on in the gut and what's out there. Something else that's interesting about the microbiome, I think, is that it really depends on how many bugs are there, not even just what types, but just the absolute number. Because the more bacteria is in your gut, the more your gut lining, your intestinal wall, starts to push this protein called defensin out, and it becomes this web that exists outside of your body to protect you from the outside world. I'll always tell patients, and I'll tell you guys, you know, if there's something on the floor, I could pick it up and eat it, right? You would think that's gross, you might not come back. 99 times out of 100, I'd be fine, right? There's virtually nothing, you know, edible that I ate that would make me that sick that was on the floor, right? But if I ground it up and put it in my veins, I'd be dead by the end of the day, right? So there's a huge difference between something that goes in your body and something that goes in your body, and that's that defense, that's that thing, right? And so your immune system, right? Your immune system isn't just this blood that you've donated now today to try to put in this repository. A lot of that immune system is here living in your gut and trying to figure out what's out there, right? Because the rest of your body doesn't really get to find out what's out there, but you put all kinds of things in here, right? Omega-3s, they're anti-inflammatory, they help repair neural tissue, they're good for you. People ask how much, and I'm like, if you eat so much that when you step out of the shower you slip, you probably had too many omega-3s. Alpha-lipoic acid is a really good antioxidant that crosses the blood-brain barrier and helps to repair neural tissue. So for my MS patients, when they've had a flare, one of the first things I'm trying to do is be like, well, let's get some alpha-lipoic acid in there. Let's see if we can help to bring that oxidation down.
Where do we find that?
Amazon. I mean, yeah. they'll bring it, they'll drone it to your house, right? It's available. I mean, I think the one thing with alpha-lipoic acid is there are two, in every chemical compound, there's two forms. what's called like an R or an L or a cis, or you know, that you have these two different forms. You're essentially looking for R lipoic acid, not L lipoic acid, but I don't think they really sell L lipoic acid. So alpha lipoic acid, ALA, it's not, there are supplements that are generally, you know, more inexpensive and others that are less that way. This is on the upper end. This is like the CoQ10 kind of cost. But, you know, to have an antioxidant that helps the brain, I think it's worthwhile. There you go. Oh, she's already on it. She's on her cart right there. I talked about, as long as you're breathing, you're healing, right? One of these healing processes is something called methylation. Methylation is just a chemical process that exists in the body that's used in a lot of different ways. But when it comes to the nervous system, methylation is really important. And so B12 is one of these major methylators. There's this folic acid and even this special methyl tetrahydrofolic acid, MTHF, that with the genome information, we're starting to learn that some people have gene defects in their folate and they don't convert as well. And then active B6, these three guys, or ladies, pass this methyl group around, and that's how they make this process work. And so if one of them is in a low amount or doesn't work as well, the whole system kind of grinds down. And so when it comes to healing the nervous system, methylation is a good thing to have on board. I always have to be a little bit evasive on those kind of questions. So if a B complex will likely have all of those in there, but the thing about a B complex is that you can get a B complex that's $4 that has some stuff in it, and you can get a B complex that's $25 and has some stuff in it. What you're looking for is this word, methyl, right? Because methyl is that process. And so what you'll see is active, you know, B complex with active Bs, or with quatrefolate, or some, you know, fancy trademarked something, right? The point is you get a lot of, you know, if you're doing this, right, you're getting a lot of good stuff from the environment. So you don't really have to think like, oh, I got to take my multi, right? But when you're thinking about a specific disease state, let's say, and you're really thinking about trying to enhance function of a particular tissue, you want to be thinking more about how can you stimulate one set of processes. And so vitamin D helps the immune system figure out who it is, right? Having the right bugs in your gut keeps your immune system from reacting to too many things and protects you from weird stuff that comes in. The omega-3s are something that just most people don't get enough of anyway, and it adjusts the inflammatory state. When we were talking about this here, this Cox-Lox stuff, omega-3s actually impact this process a little bit. So I have these on here because these are kind of the top hits of things that help. So yeah, you could just get these three, right? You could get a methyl, I think Thorne is a company we work with at the clinic, and they have something called Methyl Guard Plus, right? And Methyl Guard Plus has this, 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 and some B2. And you know, that's something that some of my patients take because I want to make sure they're getting those nutrients in. It's hard for me to say if that's something you should do, right?
No, I understand. I think I've overheard that when that's supposed to boost our immune system, that you should take that with vitamin D, and then it would be supplements.
Yeah, so I'm going to repeat the question because I'm being recorded. So the question is that with an autoimmune disease, isn't it true that you don't want to stimulate the immune system? And I think, as a whole, yes, right? I mean, but what does that really entail? Like, what does that stimulating the immune system mean? And can you really do that, right? Should you not exercise? Because exercising stimulates the immune system. Should you not sleep? Sleep stimulates, you know? So I get a little, like, weirded out about that. Like, don't take the supplement because it stimulates the immune system. And it's like, well, I don't really know how you know that, right? Melatonin was on the hit list for a while with the MS Society and other groups because they're like, well, melatonin stimulates the immune system. It's like, well, not really. And it helps with sleep, and it's an antioxidant, and it's glutathione. So I think, and you make it already. So it's kind of tricky. There, as far as I know, there isn't any clear evidence that some supplement's going to worsen a chance of relapse. Now, have they been tested to the same degree that drugs have? Not necessarily. But yeah, I mean, so yes, you're trying not to make your immune system mad, right? You're trying not to poke it with a stick. And I think that's, in some ways, kind of my point with knowing your immune globulin status, right? That if you really do have a problem with corn, and you have an IgG to corn, and then most of the food you eat is corn-based, because most of our food is corn-based, you know, are you stimulating the immune system in some way? Are you setting off a cytokine response? And so it's tricky, right? So vitamin C, I think, is an excellent supplement, and not even supplement. I mean, I think it's an excellent chemical, and I use it for a lot of different things with patients. I guess it's immunostimulatory, but it's also regulates stress. And so I just, so yes, you want to avoid something that's going to clearly put you into worse health. But I don't know if there's clear evidence that one set of supplements is going to raise your immune system and worsen your disease course. So in summary, diet and lifestyle can greatly influence the inflammatory and oxidative pathways. I hope I've showed some of that today. Antioxidants have a twofold thing. One, they alone have antioxidant activity, which helps your body. Plus, if you're eating that instead of something else, like marshmallows and Twinkies, then you're replacing bad food with good food. So you get kind of a twofold of not only are you getting some good positive thing from that, you're avoiding things that might actually worsen your health. And you know, targeted supplementation can augment a healthy diet and regulate certain processes. These are some labs that I use, some books that I recommend for diet information, some recipes that we use in our house. And this is our clinic. If you have questions or want to send an email, that's the place. Did I do it?
Yes.
All right. Thank you. Questions? That's an excellent question. So the question is, if you're on immunosuppressants, and you take a test to see what your immune system reacts to, is that a valid test? And I would say on some, it really depends. But if my patients have had a dose of solumedrol, I have them wait at least 6 weeks before we run any kind of test like that. If you're on something like Rituxan, the chances of you making B cells and that to these proteins, so you're really catching stuff that had been there before. There's some funny things about interpreting these tests that I've learned over the years. This company, I think, has something wrong with their cranberry. And so all my patients come up with a little bit of a cranberry bump. And so I can use that cranberry bump to regulate, like, all right, so if the cranberry's a 2 and your dairy's a 4, then that's almost like having a 6, you know. Or if your cranberry's a 1, then, wow, there's really, like, you didn't, your immune system's really not doing much. Or your cranberry didn't even come up. This test is probably not worthwhile. You know, so that's some things I've learned about interpreting. So if everything's low, you know, if we run a blood test and you have no immune globulins, then that's probably not a good use of your money or time. A lot of times people already know what foods they don't do well with. And because most people are a creature of habits and they eat the same kinds of things, you just try and get a good, if we're not going to do testing, usually I try to get a good diet diary and a good diet analysis and be like, well, this shows up a lot. Why don't we try and cut this out for a little bit? Let's replace this with this and see how you feel when you take some notes and keep track. Because it doesn't need to be super complex. But some of my patients really need black and white result. Like, it says on this form that I cannot eat goat milk. And so I'm, you know, and some other people are much more willing to kind of play with what works for them. Question? Yeah?
Do you have any opinions on or thoughts on ginger or turmeric supplements?
Yeah. So the question is if I have any thoughts on supplements of ginger or turmeric. So I guess it depends on what, a couple things in terms of what the goal is with it. With ginger, generally I'll use that for things related to like circulation or digestion or something where I'm trying to bring blood flow around or regulate some kind of like IBS or something. Ginger in botanical medicine is what they call a driving herb. So when you put a formula together, you'll usually have like a leading herb, the thing that you're like, I want to affect sleep, right? And then you have a supporting herb that might have some additional sleep support. And then you're doing a driving herb to drive that around the body. So ginger is a great driving herb. Cayenne is a great driving herb. It sends that chemical into the little kind of the deepest edges of the body. So a ginger turmeric formula would be a good formula that you had turmeric and you're trying to drive that anti-inflammatory activity to other places. But ginger by itself, I don't know. Like, but turmeric by itself for sure. And turmeric, typically you're looking at least a gram and a half before you're starting to see some kind of biological activity, right? So if you get a turmeric supplement, it's 150 milligrams, you need 10 of those to do something, right? If it's 500 milligrams, well, you need three, right? If it's 1,000 milligrams, you can take one and maybe another, you know? So you're looking at least a gram and a half before you start to get some kind of movement on there. And then from a food grade herb, because usually the supplements are like standardized or changed somehow, if you're just going to Costco and buying, I think, a turmeric, right? You're looking at a teaspoon of that, which is 5 grams. So there's a difference between the herb that you use for cooking and what you might find in a supplement, typically.